to laugh. I like to meet people who can make me laugh. I like having fun. Yes, I like it to laugh. I like having fun. You meet people who laugh.
Good morning! Good morning! Oh, God! I'm trying to read this article someone just sent me seconds ago. I cannot really focus on the show at the moment, unfortunately. I know that there's a lot of things going on. This is a live show. There's nothing we can do about that. We've talked extensively about potentially taping this. A lot of people have accused us of taping it. We come in here at some ungodly hour in the morning and do all this and pretend it's live. But no, folks, the reality is, truthfully, this is a live show. Now, the reason I got distracted is somebody sent me an article from an organization called Current Affairs. This is not the, what was that, Maury Povich, the Current Affair? Remember that?
Maury Povich?
Yeah. Good morning, Vic!
Good morning.
Did someone say Maury Povich? He had a program in the 80s and 90s called A Current Affair, and it was sort of a gossipy Hollywood news.
You are not.
But apparently there's a publication out there called Current Affairs, and the look at this, Vic and Doug. Current Affairs. There's us, me and Eric, on the cover from a billion-dollar movie. It says the limits of liberal comedy. Why are liberals detrimentally unfunny, and what's the left's stake in comedy? It's a very long article, and I don't understand what this has to do with us. But it does say there is one mainstream comedy film. Ain't wrong, not mainstream in any way. It was a very unsuccessful film. It did not enter the mainstream. It was not a popular movie.
Is this a new article?
It just came out, Vic. That's why I'm just reading it now.
You're the headliner of it. Yeah, I'm having trouble hearing Tim. We've got to pop him up a bit.
Really?
Yeah,
can the audience hear me?
I can hear Vic now. There we go.
Oh, maybe it was me. I was.
Listen, don't distract me.
Sorry.
I'm not concerned about your audio
issues. They put your
pictures
at the top of it, though. Like, what does that mean? Like, go ahead.
There is one mainstream comedy. People are complaining about the audio. I don't know what's been going on. It's been tremendously positive. This show's been tremendously, it's been really working well. And suddenly now the wheels have come off.
Jesus Christ.
Is it okay now? Can we get a confirmation, Matt?
Yes.
How do you we'll confirm it. Now?
Okay. I'll just read it. I haven't read it.
Just do it.
There's one mainstream comedy film from recent years that takes it as its subject the misery prevalent in modern American life and does so from an unabashedly left-wing perspective. It is Tim and Eric's billion-dollar movie, an absurdist comedy that is the sole feature film vehicle for the TV comedy duo Tim and Eric. Plot involves Tim and Eric accepting a job as managers of a dilapidated shopping mall where the few remaining businesses coexist with squatters and wild animals. Now self-styled, blah, blah, blah. We all know the plot of this movie. Tim offers Reggie a job as a janitor at the mall, and he takes it because what else is he going to do? What is this? I don't know. We can move on. Is this a good thing or a bad thing?
Just go to the last paragraph.
I guess it's saying billion-dollar movie opens with a fake ad. I don't know. Sorry I'm wasting your time on this. Your boss controls your life, but if you sit in this ghastly recliner for 90 minutes, you may distract yourself from the pain. And I don't know. You may distract yourself from the pain. Voting certainly isn't going to help. All right. Well, I don't know. Is it a good thing or a bad thing?
Pro Tim and Eric, I guess. Is it only Tim and Eric they're talking about, though? Who are they?
I think they were like going on about sort of... John Oliver and Sacha Baron Cohen and Alec Baldwin, but we were the ones that actually drilled in to talk about the actual nightmare of the current late stage. What's it called? Late stage.
Late stage
capitalism. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Well, let's reset.
Let's
folks.
Start over.
Let's start over. There's so much going on today. It's a banner show. We're 2 weeks. To the end of the year, 3 weeks to the end of the year. We're not stopping, though, folks. We're not taking the C-word break. We're going to push on. You know, last week we made the big announcement that we're not going to be celebrating C-word Christmas, I'll say it, but only in quotes. We don't celebrate that holiday here. One of the reasons is there's a lot out there already. If you want to watch the Mariah Carey Christmas special, you want to watch other Christmas specials, that's around. But the big reason is we are now officially eligible for the National Endowment for the Arts podcast grant. It's $500,000. But we have to sort of, we have to declare that we are a fully secular show, that there's no religion involved in the show. And so, therefore, we can't really acknowledge religious holidays, and we're certainly not going to celebrate them on this show. That's disappointing, I know, to certain members of our staff.
I had so many C-word drops that I was really looking forward to this year, but...
And the big news is we are going to, like I said, the Christmas falls on a Christmas Eve falls on a Thursday, and just to keep the momentum going, we're definitely doing a show Christmas Eve morning, and we're adding a Christmas morning show on the 25th. But for us, it's just going to be a regular old Friday morning for us, the two shows that week.
It sounds good to me.
But the day of C-Word? Is that what
I've said last week, and I've not changed my position on that.
So C-Word's on Friday?
I thought you were joking that C-word's time when you said Friday. That. But...
No, Vic, no, we're not joking about this.
I mean, it kind of plans.
I'm off the hook for visiting like my family and stuff. It's kind
of cool. I do too. I'm not traveling because of the virus, but like, I mean, I do have priorities at home that I probably should take care of, like kids and you know, the S word, S-A-N-T-A.
You'll just have to schedule it. I mean, all we're getting from you is 2 hours a day.
Why don't you just hire some S guy?
Let's not get into the details of how Vic is going to manage it, but I do expect you in your seat Thursday and Friday, bright and early. Let's get on with the show. Lots of going on today. We've got John Wilson, which was just picked up for a second season over there on HBO Max. Although it's a production, it's an HBO production, and it feels like one because it's got quality. It's not some kind of, it's not whatever. You know what I mean? It's a great show. We all love it. You got to be nuts not to. It's an exciting thing to think about talking to John because I don't know really much about him, and I don't have much to ask him. So we'll see. It's all pretty much
maybe a very quick interview.
Yeah, he might not be that. I'm not so interested in him. I'm interested in maybe. We'll talk to him. We'll figure it out. I do have lots of questions for John. And then, I'm a musicologist. I'm probably one of the biggest experts on music, but this guy went under my radar. I didn't know who the hell he was. How do you like that? Swamp Dogg, R&B legend, soulful singer. And I've just been, since Matt turned me on to him, I've been just devouring his music.
We also have a lot of dogs, and they're great dogs, and we cherish them.
You do love your dogs.
I've memorized all his music, and I'm going to be putting out a covers album of his later this week. Memorized. New feature on the show coming later, Ron Wood's Lick Lips. We're going to be investigating more licks of lips by the great Stones and Faces guitarist Ron Wood. Celebrities give back.
Everybody
cool out. Let's just take a beat here. Super Charity Chat, ladies and gentlemen. If you're watching us on YouTube, the Super Chat is engaged. And today, all through the month of December, sort of randomly because it's the end of the year, not because of the C word, we are giving back. And you're giving back. We're not doing anything. You're giving back. So if you engage in the Super Chat, Matt, what's the charity this week?
The charity this week is the Ashley Barnhill Medical Fund. She's a comic.
Say that again, because
I stepped on you.
The Ashley Barnhill Medical Fund. It's called the Team Ashley Skull Fund. She's a comic who had a terrible accident. There's a link in the description. Trying to help raise money for her.
Yeah,
we're
going granular this week. Last week we talked about animals. We did a big fundraiser for the ASPCA. No, the Humane Society. Also, this Saturday, I want to thank everybody for joining us for the Tim and Eric watch along of the Krimbus special. That was a huge hit. Even though it was a complete disaster, because we want to talk about this later, we were shut down by the awful folks at YouTube. Where I'm broadcasting at this moment.
They're conspiring with Turner.
What the hell are you talking about?
God forbid we throw up an old 10-year-old late night comedy special and laugh and have fun.
Dumb people.
they really shut us down within the first, but God bless Matt and Wes, who are quick on the draw, threw things over to Twitch, which we're also broadcasting on now, twitch.tv.
It's showtime!
Slash
Office Hours Live.
Which you can tip. And
they are are asleep at the wheel. We are going to be throwing up. Ever. First, we're going to put up we got a rip of Tenant that we're going to be showing later today. And watching that with commentary. How about my commentary on Tenant? Tenant? Is it Tenant or Tenant? What is it?
I don't know.
The you know what this is. You don't even know. It's
the Landlord movie?
Yeah, that's right. The Polanski movie?
It's the Christopher Nolan movie.
Mm.
Anyone see Mank? Anyone watch Mank?
No. I've been big into Bosch. You ever see Bosch? Seriously, like, it's the best.
Bosch. Whatever happened to you in Sopranos? You stopped watching?
I stopped. Oh my and God. I just put on Bosch and zone out. And
what's Bosch?
It's a good, like
cop show?
Yeah, it's like he's a cop. It's on, I don't know, Amazon. It's fun. It's very good.
Bosch, Mank stank, ladies and gentlemen.
Did you watch it all?
I did. I liked it. You know, there's things I liked about it because I was it's kind of an interesting subject matter. The politics in the 30s in Hollywood and you know, the story behind Citizen Kane. It's all this stuff, of course, I know because I'm an expert. The guy who did Orson Welles was actually really good. He sounded exactly like Orson Welles.
Did he look like him?
He didn't look. He kind of looked. He had a weird nose. I don't know what was going on with the guy's nose.
I think they could fix that these days.
But Gary Oldman was like, sometimes he was good, and sometimes his accent kept on kind of British half the time. And you know what's weird is like
sweeteners.
When the character is known to be a funny person, like the character Herman Mankiewicz was known as this like the greatest wit of the day. You know, he's just like this constantly with one line. Like he's like Doug. He was like Doug of the day, full of one-liners and jabs, or myself. And that doesn't always translate to like an actor doing it or the humor of the era. And then they did this thing where they made it all, it was like they had made it in 1938, you know? Like the production style was all that style.
Hooray for Hollywood.
Even down to the way they recorded the dialogue. It had this like kind of tinny, like they recorded it on an old megaphone or something.
Just like one mic like in the room.
Yeah. So there were scenes, it was weird. There were scenes that were like outside that had like a reverb on them. And I was like, what is going on here? I don't know.
I was listening to some guy interview Giorgio Moroder last night. And
who's that?
He's a producer, and he wrote a lot of songs. He did a lot of music for movies.
Okay.
I did Scarface.
He invented techno.
Donna Summers, he did.
That's what they say.
What was that, Scarf Ace? That's the guy that was so good at eating things quickly. He was known as a Scarf Ace. Hello.
That's good.
Go ahead. What did he have to say?
The story is not that great, but he was he did what's the guy's we're not to get lucky. What's the Daft Punk? He did an interview with Daft Punk, and they were interviewing him.
Okay.
And when he was talking about the stuff from the 40s and 50s, his early life, they had a vintage microphone.
Uh-huh.
And then with stuff in the 80s and the 70s, he had the 80s microphone, and then for the future, they had some futuristic microphone. But
guys were having fun.
They were having fun, but the dude, the producer told him, was like, yeah, no one's going to be able to tell the difference. It, like, once we, like, right. EQ it and put all the compression on it, like, no one will know. It's so pointless, but
all right,
that's what these guys are up to. Great story, guys. I have more if you want to hear more about Marauder.
Okay. I haven't even popped open my seltz yet, and I'm burping up a storm today.
Okay. I'm going to open mine, too.
Two more items of business, folks, very quickly. This is really remarkable, Matt. This is Matt Carlin all the way here, and Doug and Vic. But the Drop concert film. This is new media, folks. This is forget DVDs, forget everything else. This is where it's headed. The beautiful card. It's in this beautiful... This is real cow's leather, right? Is this real cow's leather? Smells nice. Smells like it. This right now
is cat leather from the cat trap.
This is USB technology, Joe. Jokes. Jack, this is USB technology. And you buy this fucking thing. It comes in. It's a great stocking stuffer for C-Word. And it lasts.
Wait a second. Wait, man.
It lasts forever.
I mean, Joe Biden might be listening to this.
So when it comes to selling stuff.
What else is on this thing? You've got the full feature film featuring the drop concert with Ben Levin's animation. You've got the actual audio of it. And
it's
then,
got that Rip a Tenet.
It's got Tenet.
Tenet's on here, so you don't have to pay for it online.
It's got the original stream with you, Tim, doing your intros. It's got both Q&As.
Unbelievable.
It's got drops.
This is, what, $25, and you get it at officialofficeoffices.com or wherever we buy it.
That's right.
So thank you, Dan Mulcahy, for the design.
And I just wanted to show this because of how proud I am of it, but it's official here, folks. There it is.
Hello, Facebook
the
fans.
Fear of Death album. LP.
Congrats. Look at that. They got the side thing on it, too.
And
it looks beautiful.
And I don't even know what to tell you. Well, this comes off when you unwrap it.
I know, but it looks
pretty good. Official.
And, you know, you have it all.
I love records.
It's really something. You want to own this, but it's sold out. So if you want to get it, though, I think you can get it at your local record shop.
Go on iTunes.
Get on Discogs.
Yeah. Let's put that behind Doug.
Yeah. Golly!
Put that if God wanted, I'll show you. Hold it the whole time.
Where the painting is. There you go.
We didn't even talk about the other album. The other album news.
And sorry,
we have too much. Let's not even.
You all know Slaps, Bops, and Bangers, the best of the music of Office Hours, is going to be coming out when, Matt? Shortly?
The 18th, next Friday.
That next Friday. And that's just a digital release, but we're
and
talking
cassette.
About
it. We're going to do cassette.
We're talking
gonna
about. Did you see Bandcamp is now going to do vinyl pressing?
I heard. I don't know if
that's
I trust
it. That's a great pleasure.
We're popping over here, folks.
Should we take a Zoomer? I feel like we should take a Zoomer. Or you got something?
Absolutely.
Frank Tom.
What?
Frank Tom. He looks like he's on set. Are you calling us in from on set?
Hey, Wes. Oh, there it is. Frank Tom, are you there?
Oh, his audio's not working, Frank.
Turn it up.
Give me somebody else.
All right.
Oh, hey, yeah, definitely this kid's on set. What are you shooting?
His audio's not working.
Is anybody?
No, I'm not muted.
Fail. There he is.
There we go.
Is he back? Where are you? What you shooting?
I'm shooting ceiling fans today.
Shooting what?
Ceiling fans.
Ceiling fans.
For what?
For a large hardware store that you may know.
Home Depot?
Yes.
What do these fans seal? What do they seal?
Oh, these fans seal things?
This is a promoted call, by the way.
Yeah, this is integrated product advertising.
That's,
that
the
we're
whole
doing
show
here
is just ads now.
I love Home Depot.
In the second hour.
I've got a whole lot of shakers.
What do they seal? That's a good question. So you guys aren't talking about the C word today?
No, but we have the question of the day. We have the city of the day. Oh my goodness. I'm sorry I started on this I really started on the wrong foot today with this current affairs story. I'm like Lenny Bruce on stage towards the end reading all the court affidavits and great. Grab I'm like Lenny Bruce, Doug.
I'm you? Like Lenny Bruce.
So what can I help you with today? Friend?
Well, I wondered, but I had this ahead of time. You know about Bob Dylan's C-Word album, right?
From Christmas from the Heart.
Yeah,
that's old news, though. We never talked about Bob's big news.
Man, you know what? I don't think it's that interesting.
I don't think he got paid enough.
Sure. Well, they were saying it's like a historic deal, but good for him. But I'll tell you what, Bob, you can't take it with you.
Can you share it with me?
Say that again?
I'm unaware of this news of Bob. What is, can you share that with me?
He sold his his publishing catalog to Universal for $500. Was it $500?
$300.
$300?
Yes.
$300?
Mm-hmm. Uncle Phil said he bought it for $1 million actually, on Twitter.
$300 million. $300 million is a lot for a guy that's 78 years old or 80 years old or something. You know what I mean?
I want to make sure Dylan is, what's his son's name? I want to make sure he's making
Jake
documentaries after Bob goes.
I think my drops are too low in Tim's ears because he probably
he didn't
what I was
hear
doing.
That. I know.
I heard
Free
Falling.
Can barely hear
that. So also, I was wondering, are you on what is your guys'
Yeah. I could take a little more of the guys, okay? A little more of the guys. A respectful amount. So the Christmas album from Dylan you want to talk about?
Oh, yeah. I was just listening to it today. It's very magical. I really love it.
I'll mute everybody if they keep talking about this C word.
Yeah, well, you know what? We are in danger of losing the grant money, so I'm going to move along.
Okay. Also, what is your Croc policy at office hours? Do you guys, I can't see your shoes, but are you wearing Crocs today?
Come on, man.
No, it's November. That's a summer shoe.
I suppose I'm wearing socks with my Crocs today.
Well, good for you.
I don't do the Crocs. I do flip-flops year-round, though. I will say that.
In California, you have that luxury.
Disgust a lot of people when they see my food, but I don't care.
I'll tell you something, friend. I don't care for Crocs personally. I don't like the way they feel on my body. And there's always holes in them, and stuff always gets in the holes. And then you have like rocks and pebbles and stuff.
Do you have the Crocs that they have they form fit to your toes, individual toes?
No. Listen, I have to get to the city of the day. I have to get to the city of the day because John Wilson's coming up in a few minutes. City of the day is...
Who has that song?
Why is it muted? Why is it muted, Wes?
There it is.
Do we have our package playing?
Yeah,
look at this. I put my show up pound for pound up against any of these late night clowns. Fallon, whoever. Mostly Fallon. But we're doing a better show every week. Now, could we do it every night? Well, that would require a little more capital. Because I think we'd burn out. But you just don't see this kind of production quality on other sort of streaming shows like ours. I'm proud of it. City of the Day is brought to you by G-Coins from Generous Corp. It's the holidays again. Not really. I mean, maybe it's, I guess, the end of the year. And you know what that means? It's time to donate to the needy, whether it's in a red bucket in front of a grocery store or a barista at your local Starbucks. Someone's looking for a handout. Well, now you can look generous and feel great about your pocketbook with G-Coins. Each G-Coin has a positive message on it, such as don't give up, have a nice holiday, or keep up the hard work. G-Coins are certain to fill anyone lucky enough to receive one with holiday cheer. The best part, G-Coins are not legal tender, so you can feel generous without breaking the bank. G-Coins come in three different sizes, quarter, half dollar, or Susan B. Anthony. Our coins are made out of 100% American lead, so when they hit those donation buckets, the loud clang will turn some heads and get people asking, who's that big spender? Order a pack of 8 quarter-sized G-Coins now for only $2. Just go to generouscorp.com/product/leadslugs/G-Coins and use the word Office20 to get 20% off shipping if you order in the next 2 minutes. So make someone's holidays happy with G-Coins. All right.
Tim, I appreciate your read this week.
That was a respectful read.
It was a respectful read.
Because it's a great bit. Funny stuff.
All right, folks.
And I respect the art. I respect the craft.
Mummy, mummy.
Portsmouth, Virginia is our city of the day.
Oh, really?
Portsmouth. Is it Portsmouth?
Portsmouth.
Portsmouth, Virginia. Ugh, it's gross to think about. What should we name our town, Joe?
Well, we can name it after port.
I was thinking that. That port where all them boats come in, that's like a big old mouth. And our town is eating up all the ships and all the fucking things that come in there.
Eating up all the ships?
Eating up all the ships, all the sailing ships. Yeah, let's call it Portsmouth. Portsmouth. What about Gullet? And then... Downtown Center Street. Downtown Center Street. That's called the gullet. That's called the tummy. See, our whole town is like a big old body. And way the place for the town's birth, that's the mouth.
So fucked up.
What the? I'm gonna get something from my lips. Hey, look, I look like the fort coming in. The ship's coming in right down the fort in the mouth.
Mouth is such a. I've always understood mouth to be such a disgusting word. I don't think about someone's mouth.
Lips.
What's the weather?
It's one step away from a butthole. I mean,
it's the opposite.
Yeah.
Weather right now, mostly sunny, high of 53, low of, Doug, send me home.
49.
37.
What?
Oh, yeah. It gets chilly down here on Fourth Mouth. Fourth Mouth again. Mm-hmm.
In Virginia?
Mm-hmm. All right, let's take one more caller quickly before we get to our featured guest of the day.
I thought Virginia was more of a warmer climate, but
Seth, we haven't talked to Chase in a while. Seth Chase Ahai. Reynolds, you got anything today?
Come here, son. Come here.
AKA Ramp Face.
Come here.
Not really. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Rapid fire. Let's bring him in.
All right. How about I saw somebody with Serafina.
You got Jen Stark behind.
Have we talked to Serafina before?
You know what? We should we should have a new thing on Zoom where you can just indicate through your name, like, just here to hang.
You know what?
I have a question. I need advice.
Okay, advice is, we got advice coming. Hit me.
What does her hat say?
Okay. Yeah, it's my skate crew, the whack ass posers.
Cool. Oh, I want that hat.
Okay.
I want that merch.
Thank you.
Is your advice, how do I ask Doug out?
Yeah. No.
So cute.
Okay. I'm in the house with the Trump virus right now.
Oh, really? Boy, everyone's got this thing. They said Ellen DeGeneres has it now.
Well, Ellen DeGeneres is my mom, actually.
Okay. What's your advice?
My mom has it, and I'm, like, avoiding it. Like, I haven't left my room for, like, a week. So, I know you Hollywood people probably got, like, some extra tips. Like, what do you have any advice, like, how I should avoid it?
True, my parents got coronavirus.
What do I know? I don't know. I just know you try to...
Well, I don't know.
I mean, you don't have it, but your parents do?
Your mom has it?
I live with my mom, and she has it.
Oh, you don't have it.
Is she sick with it? Is she symptomatic?
I think she just became... not contagious, but I mean, I feel like I could still get it.
Sure.
Keep your mouth away from your mom. That's number one.
Like, I'm using all my... I heard crystals really help.
They don't.
Open some windows.
I can tell you one thing. Crystals don't do anything.
Are you sure?
Can you prove they don't?
I'm just kidding. No, I definitely don't think they do anything. But I don't know. I thought maybe, like, Hollywood people get, like, extra tips.
No, you have to be a close associate of the Trump administration to get any kind of special treatment, I think. I think Rudy got the remdesivir or whatever it was.
I think you have to be one of those people to get the virus itself, it seems like, too.
Well,
right?
You know what?
You have to have it to get treated.
I don't know. Just wear a mask around your mom and keep...
And I haven't got it.
Try to keep your body clean.
Wash your hands.
My body clean, yeah.
Yeah.
Wash your face.
I'm not going to, first of all, I'm not going to give any medical advice.
Right.
That's it's irresponsible.
Because
I'm just a clown.
I'll give it. Keep your windows open.
Come on, man.
Make a little light hairspray on fire. Spray a pillow with hairspray. Light it. Burn the air. Get a fresh batch of air.
Go to cdc.gov/COVID or whatever it is. Look at their guidelines.
I'm in Doug's hometown. I can't keep the windows open.
Okay, thank you. We have to get to our featured guest. We're staying on schedule today. Maybe he's got some advice. Keep watching. We'll find out. This guy seems to know everything. He's artist du jour.
Check out his scaffolding episode.
Well, check it all out. What do you mean check out one episode? Let's get...
It's really good. The scaffolding one is awesome. It's like the most intriguing episode I've ever watched of anything.
I'm going to bring John into this conversation to refute this. This is disrespectful. John Wilson is with us.
Hello.
Hello, John.
Hey, can you hear me all right?
Yeah, of course. Wow, look at you. Nice to meet you.
How's it going? Yeah, you too. It's funny meeting this way. This is, yeah, it's quite a crossover here.
I know. This is exciting, honestly. Your show, has this beautiful grassroots kind of people talking about it, and then, you know, it's sort of been building and building the past few weeks, and now it's almost I almost want to go run contrary to it and say, you know what, it's not that, just everyone calm excited. Down
God, I hated that.
Yeah, I did notice it did that.
There's got to be blowback, John. You deserve some blowback. No, it's
there has been. Yeah, people. I mean, one of the top comments when you look on Google, the sidebar, I think it said that someone was saying that I sounded like Kermit. You know, which was a new one.
That I can hear. You've got a little bit of that that sort of Jordan Peterson timbre.
I was listening to your episode last week, and I could hear myself. Yeah, I was like listening to a recording of myself.
Well, I'm playing a little bit. I do genuinely love it. My wife and I, we've been doling it out in, we watched the last episode last night, but I was sort of, she was like, can we watch another one? I said, no, we're waiting. We're saving. We're going to have make it a special thing, because people just blast through stuff and then it's over. So
yeah.
How do I begin this week? Cause I don't do any prep or any research. So,
okay.
How did this come about?
Yeah. I mean,
how did this show come about? Let's start there. Basic stuff.
Basic stuff. You know, I started making work like this because I had some, you know, problems to work through. And, you know, I'm always shooting with like a little camera. I have them here, actually.
Yeah, let's see the star of the show.
Wow. This was the camera that I used, you know, for most of it. Very small, compact. It's like the size of a cigarette box almost. So you could be very discreet. And then I moved up to this one, which was a DV camera, because this one was better because I had a mic input, because I couldn't hire a sound guy, you know? Mm-hmm. So I started doing that. And yeah, I basically just wanted to make documentaries, but I just didn't have enough money to hire a crew. That was kind of why I started shooting everything by myself. And it usually takes about a year to make like a 10-minute movie, or historically it did. To have enough footage, but then, you know, we had to scale up for the show, and I met Nathan just kind of randomly a couple of years ago, and we just kind of hit it off and exchanged numbers, and you know,
let's drill into that. Pitch. What did he see? Where did your work exist before this show?
I somehow got the domain name johnsmovies.com like a while ago.
And these were people looking for shit, the movies about people using the toilet originally, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what they
were
looking for. And that's what Nathan was doing. Nathan's a sick guy. He was looking for toilet cam footage. And he stumbled upon John.
He still tried to fit some of that into the show, but...
I've seen a couple of those, toilet shots. What's the website again?
Johnsmovies.com. Yeah, because people, you know, I see people like, you know, that they're upset that it was only six episodes, or you know, some people are happy it was only six episodes. But but I you know, there's nowhere to nobody's telling them, you know, which is fine, that I have all these other movies, like a whole decade's worth of material that, you know, is basically identical, but just like lower production value, if you can imagine that.
Well, no, yeah, I can, because I think what you get in the HBO show is pretty good. Like, it looks, I mean, it's documentary, it's verite. I went to film school, so I know
it's
verite.
It's broadcast quality. That was, you know, it had to be HD. That was just the one, you know, the concession.
Can I ask a question?
Okay, well, first of all, John, that's not you to, that's not for you to decide.
Okay.
Tim, can I ask John a question?
Yes. Under protest.
How are you allowed to show all these people?
That was going
to
be my question.
Yeah, like, do you need...
I mean, of course that's my question, too.
Do you need a release form for these people, or is
can
it...
I, can I do my interview like with John Wilson? Like
Tim, you should ask that to him on my behalf.
The guys are so excited you're on the show. They're fans, you know? Here's my question, John. And I don't want you to bullshit me. See, this is how you do it.
you know, so, okay. So, you know, if, Tim, if you were walking around in public in New York City, you know, doing something goofy, I would be able to film you. And I probably wouldn't need a release based off what I said about you. Right. If you're a bit of a public figure, so you're kind of, you're like the Statue of Liberty or something.
I really am. That's I'm glad you're the one saying it. But what about somebody that's,
I think you could film it.
I'm like Dylan.
But what about somebody that's not so, you know, the guy, a random example, the guy in the last episode without, you know, shirtless waiting in line for the bank or whatever, like he's just open season.
open season.
Yeah. 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 Good example. That guy, yeah, I filmed near the beginning of the pandemic. I personally did not get a release from that guy, but we were in public, and mm-hmm. there's kind of like, you know, New York is a single party consent state, and you have a bit more kind of leeway than you would in California filming people in public. We basically, we release as many people as we possibly can. I'd say a good, you know, 80-90% of the people on screen, like prominently featured in sharp focus, are released.
Right.
But if there is a bit of like a, like it is a case by case basis. So it's like the shot of the person, like if you're not really saying anything bad about them or like suggesting they're doing something they're not, right. then you can usually get away with putting their image on screen.
You know, what's funny about this is like it, what it boils down to is, it's fine. It's on TV. Of course it's legal. Of course, like HBO is not going to put up something they're going to get in trouble for.
Yeah. It's all like a, you know, the lawyers, like we had the same lawyers as Nathan for you. Yeah. And I think they're kind of used to, you know, I took a lot of, Nathan brought a lot of his team from Nathan for You.
Yeah.
Like, and just like planted it straight on this production, which was great. So they were used to all these ridiculous, like tooth and nail legal arguments that Nathan would get into.
Let me ask you this. Speaking of that team, Nathan, my close friend, Clark Ranking, who
right,
is...
Right, yeah, well, that's someone we have in common,
produced,
for sure.
Produced most of Awesome Show, and, you know, he produced Moonbase, and he's just one of, like, the core guys. And now he's off doing Nathan stuff, which is fine.
Rankers.
but, and Michael Coleman. Michael Coleman is a genius, too.
Yeah, so Coleman is also a genius.
What
yeah,
was the process, and how did they, what was the collaboration like between you guys? Like, where did it, talk about that for a sec.
So, I mean, you know, I met Nathan first, and then he kind of opened up the door to all of these people that were behind the scenes of Nathan for You that I honestly didn't even really know about. Like, you know, I guess maybe I don't usually read the credits like too intensely yeah. when I watch something, but I'm teaching myself to. Anyway, so the I met Michael and Clark Ranking, and they were just great. I mean, they were pros, and Clark Ranking had produced almost all of my favorite content from the past decade. You know,
Thank you.
Wait, I have my own. I decided to bring this with
nice.
Me.
Oh, nice! Look at that. Can we get a isolated whistle yes. drop so that we can
yeah,
use
yeah,
it in
please.
Future
can
shows?
Can you put all this right. into your soundboard?
All right, let's get quiet on the set. Shh. That's forever.
Was that clean enough?
That reverb was nice too.
Yeah. No, don't have to add anything to it.
Yes.
So do you start? Do you guys sit? You guys sort of sit and sort of write the broad ideas for the episode, and then go shoot, or are you shooting a lot and then kind of building it based on what you've shot, or a little
you
bit of both?
You kind of have to. You have to shoot every single episode is different, but you basically have to. We have to shoot, write, and edit simultaneously basically the whole time, or else it doesn't work. Because, you know, real life obviously bleeds in. We did have like a formal writer's room, you know, like the WGA required whatever, 10 or 12 weeks. Mm-hmm. And that was me and Michael Coleman and Alice Gregory. And we would just talk about these kind of tent pole kind of ideas,
big themes,
whether it was small talk. Yeah, and just like, you know, all the different metaphors that could, all the different ways that you could interpret the material. And then, you know, we just lined up a bunch of stuff that we'd want to try out, like, you know, like going to talk to a travel agent about going on vacation to have fodder for small talk, you know, like that was just a small thing to try out. And then when you're there in the moment, you kind of see how far the subject is willing to take the conversation. And sometimes they cut it off really quickly, and sometimes it just, you travel with them to a different state, you know?
Yeah. And you guys are just kind of, you guys are nimble enough that you can just kind of go with the flow and take the show where it wants to go.
Yeah. And that was like, that was one thing I was worried about scaling up, because I like to kind of, you know, Mr. Magoo style, just wander into places and not really know what is behind the door. And that was, I'm sure, really frustrating for a production team at points.
Yeah.
Because I'm just walking into a neon store and talking to some guy for an hour, and they have no idea what the context is. But I usually kind of like cycle through a few different episodes worth of ideas while I'm talking to someone, and you may only see like a portion of it in the show.
Right.
But that was just only the thing that they responded well to, you know? And yeah. So, but what you're not seeing is all the stuff
that doesn't
work.
You
know, obviously that doesn't work. And there's I approached so many people.
Sure.
And it just went absolutely nowhere. And then, people think that it's too good to be true when they see certain things like going certain places, but you know, you're not witnessing all the failures.
It does feel like you're just kind of stumbling into this perfect episode, but I know, because I'm a guy that knows this stuff, it takes a lot of work.
Biz.
Yeah.
Like a low-key flex. Thank you, Tim.
I was going to ask you something else, which was, you seem like, I mean, the it's interesting. And it's the first time anyone, you know, people are really kind of paying attention to you and this show and who you are and stuff. The voice of you in the show through the narration feels, you know, there's a certain performance going on there that's probably connected to who you are, but it's, you know, it seems a little timid or a little neurotic, but it also at the same time must take a lot of confidence and a lot of sort of guts to go in and engage and talk to people freely and stuff. Is that challenging for you, or do you just love kind of going in and talking to people?
That's a great question.
Or is that sort of hard? Someone says that's a great question.
It is hard. It is like, you know, I you know, much like a lot of people, have social anxiety in a lot of different situations, and the camera is, you know, it is kind of a tool.
Right. It's a little bit of a barrier.
Exactly. Yeah. It's protection at the same time, but I don't know. I wanted to do all these things at once that I was afraid of, you know, like I hated the sound of my recorded voice. So I wanted to just start, just narrating everything just to kind of get over it and maybe even start to enjoy it.
Play into
even though,
it. Yeah.
Nathan still, you know, he still makes fun of my voice.
Well,
you know,
he's got the, I mean, his voice is also problematic in a way, you know, he's got that Peterson Kermit timbre.
He does, but he pitches up his own voice and he makes fun of mine sometimes.
I've got one of the great broadcasting voices in America, and I get no recognition for it. Very nice baritone.
Try to be a good person.
All right.
Nathan's, he's going to get his.
So what?
One of these things.
So your last episode sort of dipped into the pandemic era in New York, which is brilliant the way it kind of sort of unfolded itself to you. What have you been doing?
Uncorked, yeah.
What have you been? You've been sort of prepping for season two now. I mean, I know it was announced season two, but had you known that for a while, and you're kind of starting to get ready to shoot more?
Yeah. I mean, the shooting never really stopped. And you know, to be honest, this is the most fun I have when I'm not supervised. And like, yeah, I wasn't officially greenlit until yesterday, but you know, there's just so much going on. And like, I just didn't want there to be any gaps in coverage because like, this is the we feel like all this ramshackle stuff is going to be around forever, like because of coronavirus, but like the city is not going to look like this for much longer, I want to make sure that I shoot enough that like, I can fit this into a narrative somehow, because like, that's my greatest fear, you know, is losing a part of New York that, like, you know, forever.
Where are you,
which, you know,
where are you
all the
from?
Time.
Where are you from? Are you from New York?
I mean, I grew up mostly in Long Island. But
just like Matt,
you know,
my producer.
Parents had... Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
We're in Long Island.
Where are you from in Long Island, Matt?
Oceanside.
Oceanside, cool. Yeah. Also, my brother, my brother Tom Wilson is also a very he listens to the show religiously. So I just wanted to give a shout out to him.
Tom Wilson.
He tells me about this.
Tom Wilson. This is my last question. Tom Wilson is I guess your brother, legendary music producer. He produced Bob Dylan. He produced the Velvet Underground. A lot of great. Look up Tom Wilson. What is your relationship with the Beach Boys? I know are you related to the Beach Boys in any way, Brian Wilson or?
spiritually, yeah. Maybe. I love Brian.
Good. You're not a Mike. You're not a Mike Love fan, though.
I don't know.
I don't like Mike Love at all.
Fair answer.
I don't know. I mean, wow. I'm not a huge music guy, you know, which is why, like, my friend Francis told me about Swamp Dogg right before, you know, he was really excited that Swamp Dogg was coming on. I didn't know who Swamp Dogg was. And
can I be honest with you, John? Can I be honest with you? I don't either. But I have no idea who's on the show. I don't pay attention too much. Well,
what music do you listen to, though? What do you pop on?
Oh, I don't know. I've been listening to, I put in some Christmas music yesterday.
Hey, easy. We don't talk about Christmas on this show.
Oh, sorry.
We're going to lose our funding. You put on the score from your show. That's what you listen to.
Yeah, I put on the score from it. Yeah, the score from Barry Lyndon. I kind of just let the algorithm wash over me, you know, on Spotify.
My last question, unless you have any questions for me, which you might have. You're an inquisitive guy. There's definitely room for that. How's Mama? People want to know. How's your landlord?
She's good. She's alive and well. But I don't want to, that there's a season two in the future, I don't want to say too much out of fear of kind of spoiling an upcoming arc.
Yes, create a little drama.
Yeah, mommy, a little suspense. I don't know. I wanted to say thanks so much for having me on. I mean, I've been a fan of yours and, you know, everyone's and everyone's stuff for a while.
Thank you, Tim.
That's very sweet. We are part of a small, you know, I think we're a club of absolutely influential, talented, creative people who will be discussed in hundreds of years. And you're in that club now, my friend. And I can't wait to meet you in person when that's allowed. And thank you for doing the show. I would prefer you not do any other media appearances. I don't know if Matt talked to you about that.
We've got the exclusive.
Yeah, we want to keep this kind of our proprietary. So if you want to see an interview with John Wilson, you have to come through us. That would be preferred. Of course, we can't bind you to that, but I know you'll respect it.
It's okay. No, I'll cancel my James Corden or whatever.
Thank you for doing that. All right, John, have a blessed holiday season.
All right, you too.
Bye.
All right, bye.
Talk to you later.
Take care.
I mean, that's big. It's big.
Huge.
A lot of people are going to be talking about that. Why don't we? Well, we go right back to what's her name here on the screen with the advice. I want to take a moment. I want to take a moment to let you boys do your thing.
Multiple orgasms.
I can't say something like that. We are alive. It's so painful to hear that. For God's sake, capitalism.
You're overweight. You should exercise. You're ill.
Are you still eating your all-beef diet?
Unfortunately, yes. Life's tough, man.
God, I hated that.
Multiple orgasms. Multiple orgasms.
All right, let's get to what Multiple everyone's orgasms. Talking about. Ron Wood's Lick Lips, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, yeah.
Big new segment on the show. Ron Wood's...
We didn't have a question of the day, so...
Okay, this is a new demo. We just. Alright, if anybody wants to do a full version of that song, go for it.
Damn!
Alright, here
Jeffrey
we go.
Tubin?
We've got a new Lick of the Lips from the Ronnie Wood Show to talk about. Let's take
lick
a look.
Of the day. So you were there in San Fran.
Yeah.
There it is.
There you go. It's lick of the day.
Now, We exaggerated that. Can you play the... That's wonderful. Can you play the straight clip? Because I like how it also just...
Wait, let me try to live...
Because George helped me on Far East Man in 74.
All right. He's so...
we must have met in 73 then.
There we go.
Yikes. Did you just do that?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
My God. Yeah. You're amazing. All right.
Nice.
Thank you.
Pretty good lick. Not as big and dramatic as
guitar licks.
And he's got the lip licks.
And I knew.
Is there another lick coming up?
We have a bonus lick lips. Bonus lick lips coming in.
This is the My Pillow guy.
This is My Pillow.
Mike, the My Pillow man.
Yeah.
I knew God had chosen him for such a time as this. And by the way, he didn't choose him for one term. He chose him for 8 years.
Look now, watch.
One, two, three, four, five, six.
Eight, nine.
The My Pillow guy, he does make a great product. Great pillows. I actually use them.
You know, that pillow is a big sponge. Dries out your mouth, and it extracts all your saliva. So you're waking up. Licking those chops.
That's a good bonus lick lips. But Ronnie Wood is
you can't top Ronnie. Can't.
He's the king lip licker. Master lip licker.
Been doing it for so long. He's just a pro.
Oh, like a lizard. It's also just the way he looks in general. He does look like a lizard or a snake.
The leathery skin.
Yeah. Let's take a zoomer before we get to Swamp Dogg.
It'd be cool if he like licked all the way up to his eye, you know, like a like a frog cleaning its eye.
That's a good idea. Uh-huh. That's a great idea.
That's Bart a great Nub idea.
It's been gesticulating wildly.
Who?
Bart Nubb.
Bart Hello. Nubb. Hey, Bart. What's going on down there?
It's fine. And you guys?
It's very relaxed.
Yeah, he's comfy.
I have a very in-depth stooge question for y'all.
Okay.
So a long time ago, I got physical media, Secret Santa gift of...
Easy.
Oh,
secret
sorry.
C-word.
Secret S-word.
Or S-word, sorry.
I won't mention the holiday.
Okay.
Of the Three Stooges meet Snow White or something. And Curly and Shemp are not in it. And I was very confused.
Yeah, Joe Dorito or whatever.
So I was wondering your first interaction with... a different stooge other than Curly or Shemp in your reaction.
Sit back and relax. Enjoy yourselves a cup of Three Stooges coffee and enjoy the show.
I will admit, I could only imagine it, the first interaction would have been seeing Shemp, if that counts. Shemp would have been someone I was not as excited to see on the Saturday mornings when I was a kid. If I saw a Shemp sode coming... I ran for the hills.
I really like Shemp because he's the original. He's the original.
I grew to like Shemp, but I think...
But if you're... I'm with Tim because he might be the original, but when you're growing up watching the Stooges, you see Shemp come in. And it's kind of like maybe he's the original, but Curly came in and did it right.
I don't know. I grew up... All I had was the VHS of two of the public domain episodes. One was like Disorder in the Court, and then the other was the Trousers one or whatever, and I would watch those over and over again, and Shemp was in the... Oh, Shemp's great with his hair all over the place.
I'm with you, buddy. Yeah, I'm just saying the first time I saw something that wasn't the core three, that would have been it. And it was disappointing at first. I grew to love him just like everybody else. All right, next question. I can't talk about the Three Stooges.
There's one later on that has Shemp, Larry, Moe, and Curly in it. Like the last one, you want to check that one out. It's kind of sad to see.
Yeah, because Curly had had a stroke by that point. They bring that up in Mank. I mean, it's a big part of Mank. The Stooges, last...
Really?
No, I'm just kidding.
Should we talk to somebody else?
There is this... Yeah, sure. There is this scene in Mank where Gary Oldman comes into this big dinner party at Hearst's mansion, the Hearst Castle, you know? And he's drunk. And it's a drunk performance for the ages. It's, like, really uncomfortable to watch.
Mank.
Let's bring
it. You are always the one who told me I can say that. I could do this. I could, you know, that's just, that's the easiest thing to do as an actress. But you lied to me, son of a bitch. I just saw you from a mile away. I don't want you to think, I don't want your thanks. I'm Mick.
Tim, you gotta do a full drunk episode.
All you gotta do is watch one of those game nights. What we do. Or an Oscar special.
This is a bit of a surprise. The great Vish Khanna is in the chat room.
Whoa.
Fellow podcaster. We can make it a little impromptu crossover. Quick.
All right.
Hi, Tim.
Hey,
hi,
Vish. How are you? Hey. Looking good. I remember a couple of months ago, I had sort of perhaps innocently or just incorrectly kind of marveled at the hair growth from John Lennon from January of 68 to like July of 68. And I got a mountain of people sending me their own quarantine pictures saying, look it, I could grow a beard in that amount of time. And you have, sir, are one of the people that have proven it, that you look.
Hey, Jude.
I'm sorry. I heard something there. Yeah, no, it's true. I have it much to the chagrin of my friends and family, but yeah, it's going well. What's going on with you there? You're gonna have a beard soon. Are you gonna grow it out?
Well, this is the thing. This is weeks of not shaving. I haven't shaved, you know. That's the thing with me. I haven't shaved, but no, yeah, my hair on my face doesn't grow very fast, or it's not very thick.
I saw that you're really excited about McCartney 3, and I'm excited about it too. Have you heard anything from it yet?
All I heard was the little piece of music that's in the trailer for it, which is called something Eden, Love, I can't remember, Venus, something Venus. Love is Venus or something. And I am really excited about it. I was watching this funny video where this guy is really mad because McCartney is offering all these special editions of the album, and they're like, you gotta collect the different colors, and each one has a different demo on it, and it's just like, you know, a little craven the way he kind of puts stuff out.
Doesn't seem to someone at his level, who's a billionaire, doesn't really need to do that, but
it's interesting you bring this up because that was actually my question.
Really?
Well, sort of. It's sort of my question. I, as you know, guys, I'm in the media, and so I get advanced copies of things, and I was playing, so I got one of Slap's Bops and Bangers.
Oh,
I hope
yeah,
I said
yeah.
that. Yeah, I got it, and I was playing it in my kitchen today.
You got
my
what?
Wife thought,
to it?
I got a link to it. That's all. I didn't get a pressing of it yet. I'm sure that's in the mail. But I was playing it, and my wife really liked it. Very eclectic. She pointed that out. She liked it. And that was going to be my question. The edition I have is an 11-track download. When will we hear the expanded version with the B-sides and the rarities? Is that going to be forthcoming as well?
I feel like we kind of scraped the bottom of the Office Hours barrel to get 11 tracks. I mean, it's not our primary focus is to create original songs, but obviously now we have a Lick Lips song that'll be developed, and the question of the day was a new song. So we'll continue to do it, but.
Yeah, no, that'd be great.
There was a request for Kitty of the Day.
No.
And I was considering that as a bonus track on Bandcamp.
Some hidden tracks. Yeah. That's what people enjoy.
It just feels like a box set is coming. Like, that's all. I really want one. I'm a big vinyl head, so I want the whole thing.
Well, when we first relaunched the show after, like, earlier this year on Patreon and everything, we did post a Best of Office Hours SoundCloud mix that's not just audio, but it's like bits from the show. We should put that out again, reissue
vinyl.
That, remaster that.
That's currently being recorded to 8-track, and there'll be available.
This is excellent news. Well,
Vish, are you familiar with Swamp Dogg?
Amazon.com.
You know, as a music fan, I have to say I was no, I'm not. I'm looking forward to that interview. Yeah, you were saying you're a music head, musicologist. I'm not that familiar. I've heard the name because of Office Hours, so I'm intrigued.
James McNew from Yola Tango wrote me last night flipping out that we were having Swamp Dogg on. He goes, this is huge. So he's a real music head. He knows this good stuff. And I do genuinely, like, I'm like, oh good, I'm gonna put this on because I'm getting a little tired of my Alan Toussaint. Not really, but it's that kind of vibe. It's that kind of feels good. It's just well done. It's soulful. So you're going to enjoy his music, I'm guaranteeing.
You do love your dogs, don't you?
What else, Vish?
Swamp Dogg is on the show.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I got him coming up. What else do you have for me? Anything else? I know you're going to be talking to the boys on your show soon.
That's right. So, yeah, if people, I'm going to record this after you're done there. And so, I don't want to, you can plug it. They'll plug it. I don't want to, plug my own show, but.
Go ahead. Yeah. Creative Control with a K.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Creative Control with K's. Tim, you've been on the show many times. It's
you're a tremendous supporter of my work, and I appreciate it. You're in the
thank you, Tim.
You know, you gave a great review to the album, great review to Moonbase. You support my work, and a lot of people, by the way, don't. You know, I've Pitchfork now, not reviewing Fear of Death. Can you believe they just act as if it never happened? Even though they wrote a feature on it and everything?
I saw that. Yeah, they do that from time to time. It is one of the best albums of the year. I'm not just saying that because we're virtually face-to-face. I am a fan. It's really wonderful. I'm waiting for my vinyl copy to show up, actually. And I'm sure it'll be shipped with my vinyl copy of Slaps, Bops, and Bangers. So I'm excited.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right, sir. Good to see you, Vish.
Thank you, Tim. Okay, bye-bye.
I need to take I'm going to take a 10-minute break and just refocus. By the way, before we get to Swamp Dogg, one more thing I wanted to bring up. On December 17th, LA Gives Back is going to do a charity telethon for a very... If you go to lagivesback.org or something, 12:17, starts at 5 p.m., it's going to be on Twitch. Me and Natalie, the great Wiseblood. Give me a pop, a half a cup. Thank you. We did a...
Yang, see?
Sorry to interrupt. Very rude of me.
We did a cover.
Just a snort.
We did a cover
That's good.
Together of a Tom Petty song. Did I send this to you, Vic?
No.
I just sent it to Matt. Came out really nice.
Free balling?
No.
Free balling.
You're going to want to check it out. We'll try to put it up after the telethon if that's possible, but it came out really nice. So that's LA Gives Back. It's a tremendous night of music and all kinds of Eric Andre.
Isn't that like a 24-48? He asked me to do that.
It's like a telethon, but we pre-tape. I'm not going to go up at 3 in the morning and fucking put on a musical show. Come on. Let's talk to Swamp Dogg! I hope I didn't hurt his ears or your...
Swamp, we're not hearing you. We're seeing
come on,
you.
Man. Are you kidding me? Swamp Dogg!
Yeah!
Hey!
There he is.
Video.
How you doing?
I am doing... It's an honor to have you on my show. I want to tell you that right away.
It's an honor to be on your show. Can you see me?
I can't see you. And what are you seeing?
Oh, good. I can't see me.
Can you see me?
All those people.
I'm the good looking guy, Tim.
Tim Heidecker.
That's it.
There we go.
Yeah, okay.
Listen, I'm a new fan. I just became a fan. Okay? I'm sorry I wasn't there from the beginning with you. I'm not following your career. Mm-hmm. Matt turned me on to you. Your last record was produced by Bon Iver? Is that correct?
Bon Iver.
Boney Bear.
Justin.
Yeah, Boney Bear.
So, but you've been out there making records for how many years?
Oh.
40 years?
Since 1955.
Well, Vic was right. You've been making records since 1955?
Told you.
Yeah. Because I only put out one record between 1954 and 1959. 1960.
So
we only had our one local record.
Talk to me about this album, though. That this rat on with you sitting on that big rat. What's that about?
Oh, that was the second album I did when I signed with Elektra. I got on the shirt here. I'm still advertising it, trying to make it sell.
Do we have a picture of that rat?
Yeah, me on the white rat.
Well, it's a very. I love it. It's a very funny image. What does it have to do with the? Is there a song on there, Rat On, that I forgot? I can't remember.
No.
Is this you on a rat?
Actually, the rat was
there it is.
There we go.
Was the white man.
Oh.
And if you look at the rat, you see he's got a smile on his face.
Yeah.
And me, naturally, I'm the black man.
Yeah.
But what everyone knew and felt, as a black man, I wouldn't be on top
right
too long. Right. Therefore, the rat is smiling because he says, this fool think he owned or something. Ain't nothing happening.
He's about to buck you off.
Now you figure I'll fall off on my own.
That's awesome.
Which I did.
Yeah.
So,
you know,
that's in Lectra, I guess they got real pissed because I did it. Then they read the fine print of the contract and saw that I had complete autonomy over the over everything, the
right.
music, the album cover, and they tried to get me to change it, and I wouldn't change it. Yeah, words and shit. I ended up off of Elektra.
Oh, really?
Hell, that was it.
That's it. So
yeah.
One thing that I really that really sort of speaks to me with the new record is how much it sounds like a classic. I mean, what's the production process? Are you guys in the room together? Are you trying? Are you making it like you made it in the 70s?
No.
The records now? No.
Hell no.
What's the process?
The process is whatever's going on today, and what I want to hear and what I want to do. Now, that may sound a little vague. It sounded vague as hell to me. But if I'm looking for a particular sound or something, just like the album before this country album was Love Lost and Auto-Tune.
All right.
Well, I wanted Auto-Tune.
Yeah.
So I couldn't have pulled Auto-Tune from the 50s or the 60s or the 70s.
Maybe well, what was your relationship with John Prine? You did a beautiful cover of Sam Stone, and then he appears on this last record, and of course he passed away this year. But what was your relationship with John Prine?
John wrote Sam Stone,
right?
And I had a minor hit with Sam Stone, and there was all types of publicity being done by the company and so forth about Sam Stone with the radio stations and so forth. And I was going around doing little promotions with radio and so forth. And John and I met in 1968.
Wow. That's good. That goes back a while for him, right?
Yeah. He had just signed to Atlantic. I had just been given the position of in-house producer. And that was only because I was black. And I ain't getting ready to go into a racial thing, but that's what it was. Anybody who had walked in that was black at the time I walked in would have got the job,
right.
Mainly because all of the black organizations was down on Atlantic Records. And Jerry Wexler even took a beating from them. Physical beating down in Miami at the disc jockey convention.
Wow.
And because they had producers, black producers, But these black producers were all in Megan and Muscle Shoals and Nashville and Memphis. And there was no one representing black in house.
Right.
So I became the in-house producer, and they could point to me and say, see, we got one.
Right.
And that's what that's the way the shit went. But I didn't know that. First of all, I didn't know nothing about politics. So I didn't know that until I became Swamp Dogg. I forgot the question.
No, that's okay. Well, I'm just talking about John Prine, but he's on the new record.
Yeah. John and I had planned to tour together hopefully sometime this year or next. And I was going to Ireland, and we were going to stay at his house for about a week and do nothing but write songs.
Yeah.
And, but hey, that couldn't happen because he got sick.
Yeah.
And,
that's terrible. That's terrible. It's been a terrible year.
I know. He's among what I consider the greatest songwriters in the world. I think John Prine, this is not the order in which they fall, but I figure John Prine, Smokey Robinson, Mickey Newberry, that's the first three that comes to my mind as really great writers who had something to say and knew how to say it.
Right.
I did a Mickey Newberry song, if you never heard of it, because she even woke me up to say goodbye. And that's on the Right On album, I believe. Yeah. It's on the Right On album.
You got a song to play for us today?
Yeah. I wrote She's All I Got. And I'm prepared to sing that semi a cappella with my partner.
Semi a cappella. Sparse version.
Yeah, that's right. We're using one instrument or two instruments, my voice and his keyboard.
All right. Well, as you know, Zoom audio is always a little tricky with live music, but we're going to do our best. Please forgive some of the quality if it's not pristine audience out there. It's an honor to have you on the show. I encourage everybody to do a deep dive on your records. Everything I've heard so far has just been exactly what I've been in the mood for. Man, it's good. It makes me feel good. And
which album you like the best?
You're gonna put me on the spot. You gotta put a gun to my head, huh?
No, I'm not. Just name either one. I don't know the difference.
Well, I'm not there yet. I'm not an aficionado. I don't know. I've been listening to the new one. I've been listening to Rat On. That Rat On seems like a classic. So despite that weird album cover.
Okay, there's another one that's weirder than that, I think, which is Gag a Maggot.
Okay.
And yeah.
All right. That's got some stuff on there. A Mighty Mighty Dollar Bill and Choking to Death from the Tazzy Band.
All righty then.
Total Destruction to Your Mind is cool, and the album covers are incredible.
Okay.
I just want to say that. I mean,
everybody calls that incredible.
Yeah, there's stuff I've never seen
that
before.
That damn cover was out of focus.
Yeah. I like the look of it.
Which one can I see? Yeah. What's it called?
Total Destruction to Your Mind. I mean, it's just...
Yeah.
Right there. It just has a look that you don't really see on other albums.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact...
It's real.
The guy... The photographer, he wanted to break in the show business as a photographer, but he didn't have any except the one that he made for himself, which he was the photographer down at the jailhouse. He did all of those
mugshots.
Yeah.
Huh? Mugshots, yeah.
Oh, my nice. God.
Yeah, myself was the first legit, not use that loosely. that,
all right, what are you going to play for us, Swamp Dogg?
Well, my partner, I forgot your name, Moonstar. And see, you can do shit like that when you get older. You can say, oh, I forgot who the hell you are.
All right. Should I accompany you on the guitar? No, I think, no, I'm just kidding.
He's gonna play the keyboard. I'm gonna sing. Actually, the biggest song I ever had in my life, still living on it, called "She's All I Got." Some people call it "Don't Take Her." She's all I got. And it has sold millions, and at least 75 different artists has done it.
All right. Take it away.
Especially in the country category.
In the what?
The country category.
Oh, yes. It sounds like a country standard. All right, sir. She's all I got, and you're all I got in that lately.
All right, play it. Well, I said, friend, don't take her, she's all I got. Please don't take her love away from me. I'm telling you, friend, don't take her, she's all I got. She's everything in life I'll ever need. She is life. When I want to live, she's everything to me in life, the life you give. She's my water when I need a drink. She's the first thought in my mind each time I try to think. Let me tell you now, friend. Woo! Don't take her, she's all I got.
Just hold it. Yep. You never... Okay. That was awesome. Dude, that was awesome, man. That sounded really good on our end. I love it that you're just
sitting... working on it for 65 years.
I like that.
It should be awesome.
What's amazing is so full of soul and beautifully performed. And there you are sitting with your headset mic on with the Venetian blinds behind. It's like you're a travel. It's like I'm like checking in with a travel agent, and he's also singing me a beautiful song. So, Swamp Dogg, thank you so much for coming on our show. It really is an honor. I'm going to break protocol here and wish you a happy holidays.
Well, I wish you one too.
And happy new year, and may the next year be, you know, a little better than this one. So please stay happy and healthy.
Yeah, well, I'm going to do that. I'm going to stay happy. I mean, my health is not up to me. So is this the end of my segment?
That
I took a shower this morning.
I think, yeah, I don't want to keep you. We run a tight ship over here, man. This is like tighter than the Tonight Show.
I have one question, like, what's the secret or the key to having such a long career in the arts and music? What?
Don't give that away, Swamp Dogg.
Is there a secret? How do you do it? How do you make that happen?
Oh, everybody.
Okay.
And they'll keep you alive. They find out about things that you can make money with.
Uh-huh.
They'll call you and say, Swamp, there's a commercial, there's this, there's the other, because they want their money back. So that's, you know, everybody is on your side, even though they didn't volunteer for it.
That's smart.
There you go.
All right. Listen, we'll have you on again.
Well, we sure look forward to it. Where are you located?
Oh, I'm in Glendale, California. Where are you?
Oh, shit. Right up the street.
Where are you?
Could've stayed in the bed, huh?
Well, next time we'll do it in person when we get that beautiful vaccine. That. Are you going to get that beautiful vaccine, or are you one of these people that don't buy into that?
I buy anything that I think going to get me another hour.
Yes.
There you go.
Amen to that.
Yeah.
All right, sir.
So, I mean, we've been, hell, that's another story.
Well, I'll call you later and I'll book a trip to Barbados. I mean, you can find me some good cheap airline, like some airfare.
Oh,
or some car insurance or something. All right, sir. It's an honor. Take care.
Hey, thank you, Matt, what's your last name?
Well, Matt?
Thank you. My name's Matt Carlin, but you're talking to Tim.
I'm Tim Heidecker.
Doug's got a quick question.
No, I don't. I'm saying we're muted. I'm trying to put applause and drops.
Oh, we're muted. They muted us.
Yeah. Oh, there we go. Performance. That's right.
All so
right.
We're just talking to ourselves.
No, the guys, the sound effects here were muted, so it wouldn't override your music.
Let's do it in person again next time, man.
We'll do it in person. We'll have a live performance in the flesh next year.
Okay, we could do it in my studio.
There we go.
Yes, sir.
That's what we did not a few weeks back. We did a concert.
All right.
Americana Highway.
Yeah. Oh, sounds good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyway, thank you.
Until next year, the great Swamp Dogg, ladies and gentlemen. It has been terrific. Listen, he's a legend. There's no question about it. I encourage
everybody
to...
Did you say he's in Barbados?
No, the joke I was making was because it kind of, in the most respectful way, it looks a little like he's like at a travel agency or something with the headset mic on and the Venetian blinds.
Respectful way.
And I was just making a joke that I'm calling him for some airfare.
But he said he's right up the street, so he's nearby.
Just come on by.
Somebody in the chat was saying Swamp Decker collab.
I love it. By the way, speaking of the super chat, Doug, it seems like somebody has cracked the code for City of the Day. Is that correct?
Wow.
Or have they have a guess?
No, I mean, we didn't want to really.
Well,
if they're on the chat, we could get them in and see if they could.
They super chat, or this is in the Zoom?
There's a super chat. That's why I'm acknowledging it because I think.
I screen capped it and send it to you guys on the down low, but.
Yeah. We should. I didn't see. Pull that person up real quick.
Baby. I really
My
do.
Tech ID.
I really do like that kind of music, man.
It's
I do,
beautiful.
I do like that. I do. I really do. I'm not putting anybody on.
No.
Why not? It feels.
It hits you. You know.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Emotional thing.
And it's got energy. It gets me moving. I'm in the kitchen
great
doing the dishes.
Session guys in the back.
Putting
there,
the dishes in the dishwasher. Yeah. Loading them up. I was loading them up, and my wife said, "That's not how you do it. You got to put it in this way." He said, "Well, you do it then."
Why don't you just take your balls out of your wife's purse? Make a stand for one time in your life.
Matt, let's take a zoomer. We are rounding down. We've got... By the way, if you're not a Patreon, you're an idiot. and you're stealing content. That's what you're doing. You're getting it for free. There's no free lunch. Patreon.com/office hours live at 11:30. We're going live on the after hours broadcast. Some say it's even stronger than the main show.
Many people are saying.
Many people have said this, and frankly, at this point, I believe them. And anyways, let's talk to a couple more people before we say our goodbyes. Of course, we'll be back next week.
Claire, you got something?
Hello, everybody.
You got a topic?
Rockin' Julie.
I'm so nervous.
What are you nervous about, Claire? I'm a puppy dog.
Holy shit.
Come on.
I don't even know what to say. Just thank you guys.
Well, you're welcome.
My brother, Timmy, shout out to him. We watch you guys all the time.
Where are you at? I like that lamp.
Duet crew. Vic, we love you.
What's your, where are you calling in from?
I'm so nervous. I'm in Santa Monica.
What is it? We're basically a local show. Every day, somebody from L.A., Hollywood, Santa Monica, Glendale.
From Detroit, though. Originally from Detroit.
I got to get the international audience back. I had people calling in from Dubai and Vietnam and everywhere.
I know. What happened? I don't know why.
It's the Zoom. It's the Zoom. But, well, listen, what's your day looking like?
I'm working my 9-to-5 job right now. Just a 9-to-5-er.
So. Kind of look like Amy Schumer. Everyone ever tell you that?
I got that a couple times in the past. I don't know if I like that.
Yeah.
Reference, but.
Was it kind of like, hey, am I looking in the mirror? What's going on here? Tell me, take your glasses off. Maybe not so much.
No, now it's.
Okay.
Less.
It was the glasses that were obfuscating things. How dare you? You wrote me into a false narrative. Okay,
so I have
I'm being told by my producer that we have to wrap things up. This is the best. Peace to you. All right. Okay. My son, by the way, my son knows this now as rock and roll. He goes, rock and roll, Dad. And I don't want to tell him. It means it's a sign of the devil himself. By the way, he also has this thing, which is when he's pooing, when he's making two, that in his mind, and he's kind of serious about this, is that the poo is at work, and that they're going the poos are going home. And so as he's trying, as he's sitting there going, he's like, the poos are still at work. And they're going home. They're home. They're driving home now, and they're in the toilet.
I like
home.
That the kids, they don't have shame about it. It's just like a thing. It's just a natural thing. And then they learn over time.
Learn shame. That's the key. Grow up, you must learn about shame and be disgusted by your own body.
Uh-huh.
Mouths. We talked about mouths today.
Tim, that's a good children's movie or book. Yeah. It's about the home where all poo goes. So it's like this place and it's just filled with poo.
Yeah. All right. My friends...
We
got to
shout out a lot of super chatters today.
Yeah, shout them out.
We won't do it by name, but I just do want to acknowledge. And on Twitch, we have subscribers now.
Nice.
I don't really know how that works, but thank you.
I want to say, because we're doing a charity for the super chats, I don't feel so obligated to acknowledge them personally. It's really about the good nature, good-heartedness of
Tim,
you.
When can we get these holidays over with so we can get this super cash money not going to charity?
Again, if you want to buy your loved one or your friend or your foe an Office Hours piece of merchandise, we got the Drop Concert wallet, which is unbelievable, the shirts, the hats, the totes, and everything. Last day to order is Monday. I want to keep stressing this. And if you're a Patreon, you get discounts on that merch. So make sure you get it in by Monday. I don't want anybody saying to me on C-word Eve, can I get I wanted to get one of those Casey Kasem shirts, man. What am I going to do? My dad's going to beat the shit out of me. I'm calling from Portsmouth. I want to swallow some of that merch. All right.
Bullshit.
Doug, anything you want to promote?
What the fuck does that mean?
Out of the magnanimous
You got
graces.
The Poundcast. You can check the Poundcast out. That's
there you go.
For now.
Aren't you having a Poundcast party tonight? Is that tonight?
Yes, it is, Matt, but that's
for what? What's that for?
Well, you join up. You could join.
That's for our patrons only. Thank you.
Big news. I've been chewing a lot of gum lately. I don't know what that's about. I'm going to be chewing gum during the After Hours show. Everyone's going to have a blast watching that. Thank you, everyone, for watching. Thank you to John Wilson. That's the exclusive John Wilson interview. It's the definitive one. I'm sort of like David Frost now interviewing the greats, and people will look back on this years to come to study John Wilson and everybody else, including Swamp Dogg.
And people can go to my YouTube channel to subscribe to my YouTube channel.
Remember,
if you want Patreon, buy my albums, listen to my albums.
No C word for you. You and your kids are going to have to adjust.
Have to talk to them tonight about that.
And we'll be back next week, ladies and gentlemen, with another Super Office Hours show. Thanks to Matt Carlin. Thanks to Wes, our engineer, who's very off the ball at the beginning of the show, but has gotten things back on track. Thanks to Ron Wood's lips. And to all you watchers, spread the good news. The good news is not the Bible, that bullshit. It is Tim Heidecker's Office Hours, where the truth is finally told for once and for all. See you in After Hours, my loves.
Asbestos mouth.